At CIG TV Studios, I'd like to welcome the media as well as you, the listening and viewing public. I'd like to begin by introducing our sign language interpreter, Ms. Carolyn Powell. She's going to be with us going forward on all of our press briefings for our hearing impaired here in the community. Now I'm going to introduce the panel, starting with His Excellency Governor Martin Roper, our Premier, the Honourable Alden McLaughlin, the Honourable Duane Seymour, Minister of Health, the Honourable Juliana O'Connor Connolly, Minister of Education, and Dr. John Lee, our Chief Medical Officer. Again, welcome to everyone. Dr. Lee, we begin with you.
Good afternoon. This is to announce the results since the announcement yesterday. 23 additional samples have been run through the Health Services Authority laboratory, and all of those 23 samples have come back negative for COVID-19. I also wish to make another announcement, which is long-winded, I apologize, but for legal reasons I feel it's necessary to do so. The medical officers of health shall report to me in that under the public health law they shall at all times exercise such powers or discharge such duties subject to the general or special directions of the chief medical officer. Under section 24 of the public health law, whoever refuses or neglects to comply with any direction given by a medical officer of health, having at its purpose the prevention, control, or suppression of infectious disease, or enters a hospital or other place used for the reception of carriers or persons suffering from an infectious disease, or leaves such hospital or place without the permission of such an officer, or refuses or neglects to comply with any of the requirements or conditions of observation, isolation, or surveillance, is guilty of an offence. I am announcing that I require all returning people to this island to be isolated, subject to the description as given by the Premier earlier in the week under the Public Health Law, Section 24.
Thank you, Dr. Lee. Premier McLaughlin.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining in and listening. I just want to underscore what the Chief Medical Officer has just said. We require that anyone who is returning to these islands isolate for a period of 14 days. If it is not self-isolation, then they must be isolated in one of the facilities that the government has made available. Thanks to our private sector partners, the hotels, who have been so good and such good corporate citizens to allow us that facility. Today has been another grim day for those that follow the news internationally with respect to COVID-19. Italy has announced that its deaths, which now exceed 4,000, are greater than the number in China. Now that is quite amazing, actually, when you think that Italy is a country of 64 million people and China a country of 1.4 billion. And you really must ask what has made the difference. There are really important lessons, I believe, in what has transpired and is transpiring in those countries. In the case of China, they immediately put into place, as soon as they became aware of the nature of this virus, very, very stringent provisions relating to the movement of people, essentially. I don't know if they use the term social distancing, but that's in effect what they did. And it made all the difference in the world. Italy and many countries in Europe and indeed in the United States went about it a bit differently. And quite frankly, waited a very long time before they sought to, in the context of this virus, to impose those restrictions. And now we have a situation where overnight, Italy recorded 631 deaths. In the UK, in the US, California, state of 40 million people with an economy the size of that of the United Kingdom, is now in full lockdown, as is New York. Here, we are doing everything we can to get ahead of the spread of the virus by imposing the measures that we have. So far, so good. But this has a long way to go and a long way to run. We are, as I've repeatedly said, with the sheer number of visitors that we have in the course of any week, although all visitors are now prohibited as of yesterday, as of the close of that aspect of the airport operations yesterday, and the number of returning residents, we are still at real risk of the community spread of this virus. And that is why I have asked the Chief Medical Officer to refer everyone to the provisions, or that particular provision of the public health law, to ensure that everyone takes, who's returning or has returned recently, takes seriously their obligation to isolate. Turning now to what I will call some good news relating to the measures, or some measures that are being taken by the banks, and indeed now, and Cayman Water Company, as well as Rubis, the fuel supplier. I'm really happy to say that I am so pleased that corporate Cayman is so conscious of the need to help everyone get through these most difficult economic times that are yet to come. There are going to be much, much tougher times coming than the ones many people are experiencing this week. And so it is good that Cayman National Bank have also now offered a blanket 3-month payment holiday to persons who have loans with them. That is to be absolutely applauded. And Cayman Water Company, too, has also agreed, as did Cayman, as did the Water Authority, not to disconnect people for at least 60 days and to work with people who struggle to pay their bill at the end of the month, and to offer payment plans in that regard. Rubis has issued an announcement saying that it, with immediate effect, it has reduced the rack rate of fuel by 40 cents a gallon, and are urging the retailers to apply this immediately at the pump. So those are provisions are going to continue to offer major breaks to all of us as we struggle through what is bound to be a difficult economic period for the foreseeable future. I think the payment holiday the banks are offering will be of real, real assistance to people who are self-employed and to businesses, particularly small businesses, because there's going to be, and I'm sure already is in many cases, a significant downturn in business, and they will have the ability to keep what would have been their mortgage payment to help get through that difficult time, or this difficult time. I am convening discussions next week with my caucus and my cabinet, and indeed I am proposing to invite the opposition into some of those discussions to talk more broadly about the economic issues that the country is facing and how we grapple with them. For even if this virus, this epidemic were to come to a screeching halt in a month's time, what's happening more broadly to the global economy will take much longer to come back to anywhere near where it is now. And we all have to plan and make provision for how we survive what are going to be very lean times, I believe, through the end of the year at least. So these are issues which I think deserve and warrant national discussion, and so we certainly want to involve the opposition in those talks. I'm also convening a special meeting for us to look at government finances and where we are and how government gets through this period as well. As I've said many times, government is very well placed given the prudence that we've exercised over the course of the last 7 years. But with the tourism industry completely in tatters and virtually no revenue coming in from that end, and with what's happening in the financial markets, no question whatsoever that financial services are also going to be very seriously hit. And so we have to plan for the way forward to ensure that the Cayman Islands government, not just for the next few months, but for the foreseeable future, is in a position where it can continue to pay its bills, pay its staff, and do all of the other things that are necessary to help our people and our businesses, who themselves will be struggling just to survive through this very, very difficult period. So I think with that overview, I'll ask the governor to make whatever observations he wishes.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. And let me just first of all say that I fully support everything that the Premier has just said. And indeed, to back up what he was saying about what's happening globally and where we are in Cayman, I was looking just earlier at the World Health Organization, the latest advice. I mean, they're saying much remains unknown about this virus, but a number of countries and communities have successfully brought outbreaks under control. And their advice is act early, act fast, test every suspected case, break down that chain of transmission. And that's exactly what we are doing here in Cayman. So again, I strongly support the greater clarity to our returning students and residents on self-isolation, because that is really important. And we continue to take the proportionate response to the risks that we face. And it's welcome again that we have no new cases today, that the latest batch of cases are all negative. I also think we are, in a way, fortunate that we are a long way from where many countries are in experiencing this virus. So that does give us an opportunity to learn from what they've done well and what they have not done well. And that gives us an advantage in how we tackle this. There is a lot of work going on. I think people find it very difficult because we can't put a timetable at the moment globally on when this will end. But there is a way through, and that should give us hope and confidence. There's a lot of work going on vaccines. It will take time. Boris Johnson, the UK Prime Minister, yesterday announced that there is a development of a home testing kit which can be rolled out and would be rolled out very quickly. And that would then offer the possibility of being tested, and if you're clear, you would be able to go back into the workforce. So I just want to convey that there is a huge amount of work going on to try and help us find ways out of the situation that we are in. And of course, if those home testing kits are available, the overseas territories would absolutely be part of that. I just want to make two final points. One is that a lot of people have sought to leave our islands this week whilst the airport is still open on the BA flights and many other flights. I think once we get past this weekend, we will need to look at whether there are people who still have emergency travel needs. So we are exploring, or we will set up an emergency travel hotline next week, and we'll give more information on that next week for lots of people on the islands who might have questions about how do I get out if I absolutely have to get out, whether it's a medical emergency or some other reason. And I finally just want to say a big thank you to all our staff, Customs and Border Control, and at the airport this week particularly, because they have been on the front line. It's been an incredibly busy time at our borders this week, and they've done a terrific job. So thank you to them. Thank you.
Minister for Education, the Honourable Juliana.
Thank you. Good evening to all. I'll first start with a general synopsis of what has been undertaken with the ministry. Our ministry, MISL, the senior management team, has developed and now fully fleshed out our business continuity plans and protocol, which includes various scenarios as it pertains to the progression of the coronavirus here in Cayman. We are now in scenario 2, which covers a confirmed case in the community. Scenario 2 consists of our staff working remotely, utilizing digital tools such as Zoom, WhatsApp, emails, Citrix keys for off-site operations. This plan is being followed by the operational arms of our department and the various units within the ministry. I'll move on now to education. As you would know, we took the decision, Honourable Premier and government, to close our educational institutions on Monday, the 16th of March, and we are currently set to reopen the 27th of April, 2020. The measures that have been employed by our schools to prepare for such school closures, our Department of Educational Services sent out a survey to all of the parents in order to ascertain the access to the levels of technology in their respective residences. To date, we have received 1,600 survey responses, and that is of yesterday. The deadline for the response is today, so we would urge all outstanding recipients of the survey to please make every effort to get them back in so that we can go to the implementation stage of our respective policies. Home learning contingencies have been implemented in our schools. Each school has provided educational instruction through a combination of channels, including paper-based learning packages, a daily timetable, and access to online platforms. The government schools have put in place online platforms as follows. Twinkle, PowerMath, iCompute, iXL, RASKIS, in order to facilitate continuous learning among our students. We are also in continuous communication with our parents. The main online platform that our government schools have implemented to communicate with our parents and guardians is the virtual learning platform Everest. Let me repeat that again. The virtual learning platform Everest. Parents, guardians can also communicate with their schools using the different media such as their WhatsApp groups, Class, Dojo, Edmodo, email, Facebook, InTouch. And InTouch allows messages to be sent to our parents and guardians. The effect that this will have on grade 11 students, in particular as it relates to CXC, today we are unable to say exactly how the closure will affect year 11 students who have final exams coming up. And this is because CXC has presented a number of options, and our team is considering those options and the impact in the upcoming school year. And once that consideration has been duly completed, we will revert again and make the necessary communication. As it relates to GCSE, the UK Department of Education just yesterday announced that all summer sittings of examinations have been cancelled. This includes our A-level and our GCSEs. As more details come to light, again, we will duly inform the public. Access to CXE study materials. We are currently exploring access to CXE content through a public-private sector partnership with Flow. We will continue this communication and dialogue with them, and if successful, this will allow our student who are undergoing examinations to continue their learning and practice directly as it relates to the CXC syllabus. We are continuing to monitor developments internationally and within the region. Access to Zoom. Teachers do not have to pay for Zoom, and this is one of the questions that have been emanating from that sector. There is a free version of Zoom that is available. It can host 100 participants up to 40 minutes for group meetings. This also allows unlimited meetings, which give teachers the option of multiple of 40-minute sessions with their respective classes. There are plans for students without internet at home. The schools have created and, in fact, have now distributed take-home packets for students without technology access. There's also monitoring of the online teaching. We have requested that all of our principals ensure that all necessary steps and provisions are made for learning to continue. Based on the information from the principals and teachers to date, they are taking these necessary steps and will continue to expand the curriculum provision based on any new resources that may become available. Moving on now to tips for parents to monitor home learning. We would once again emphasize that education involves a tripartite relationship with the government, the teachers, and the parents, and we're now calling on the parents to join up and invest in this partnership. We would ask you to create a quiet workplace for your children away from distractions and indeed encourage them to maintain good learning and working habits. This will indeed allow you to simulate the classroom environment and maximize the learning effect. Communication with students. Teachers will continue to communicate directly with parents and students through traditional communication methods such as telephone, WhatsApp messages, and emails, as well through the class Dojo, Edmodo, Google Classroom, Skype, and Zoom. Guidance to parents who have not yet received and take home packages. Parents who have not yet picked up your packages with the learning materials or who have additional questions may contact the respective principals and or the school directors at your child's school. Additional access to information of COVID-19 in schools for a trusted and reliable source for all official updates and information on COVID-19. Monitor daily or the press conferences, and indeed you can visit the website at www.gov.ky/coronavirus. Moving on quickly to the returning residents, as we know, based on our talk show yesterday and monitoring that have been coming in from our Q&A section, 8 of those persons scheduled to arrive on international flights today have opted to utilize the dedication isolation facility. That, of course, will change based on the announcement from the CMO today. There were 29 persons currently housed at the facility. A team from the ministry and volunteers from some of our departments have been at the airport since yesterday, working to welcome and assist the returning students. Bus contractors and janitorial teams have been deployed through DES, Department of Environmental Services. Buses are fully clean and sanitized after each trip. Scholarships. A proposal has been put forward to waive fees for students applying for full overseas and local transcripts. The proposed period commences 23rd of March and will end on the 30th of April to be further extended if it's deemed necessary. Free school meals. All primary school canteen providers are on board. The John A. Primary School was not spoken to because they had asked to engage in a voucher program. We have received full support from Kiwanis and from the Feed Our Future to run a voucher and a daily lunch program. Feed Our Future will provide vouchers from fosters and will deliver to schools. They will also collect the Kiwanis vouchers. The Feed Our Future will pay the canteen operators directly using existing protocols. Moving on next to my area responsibility for the Department of Agriculture, to respond to some of the inquiries from our farmers. As it pertains to the operating hours of the various units and services under DOE, or Department of Agriculture, such administration nursery will continue to open, as well as the warehouse, abattoir, animal control services, and updated operating hours will be available on our website, which is www.facebook.com/agriculturecayman. And it will also be available at www.gov.ky by the end of today. Our efforts to protect our staff and our customers are regularly updated and placed on our social media platform. Installation of an outside sales window has now been established in Cayman Brac. Reduced hours and office closures have been posted on that office. This is done in an effort to reassure the public that we are taking all precautionary measures necessary. All vulnerable employees have been sent home to self-isolate, and we continue to monitor our staff in the event there's a need to take further action and related to further requests for isolation. Redeployment has been activated internally. Flexible work arrangements have been arranged for the staff at agriculture to allow them to also work remotely. We have increased our sanitation efforts in order to prevent the various measures, and they're still being practiced and communicated to those who need to have this relevant information. We have heightened our efforts also in this area. The Department of Agriculture has significantly increased our ordering for feed and fertilizer to ensure that we can meet the demand of our local farmers. Despite significant increases that we've seen in the recent weeks, the department has assured me that they have been able to service every customer's demand to date, and we are certain that we have adequate supplies en route. Every effort will be made to service our commercial farmers first, as is the normal protocol. Farmers who have ordered seedlings will be notified anon when they are ready for collection. The Animal Control and Welfare Services trapping service has been temporarily suspended. The animal shelter for rescue is now closed. We will continue to monitor and address any serious animal welfare or control issues. The farmers market continues to operate, as we believe that it's akin to the supermarket and is an essential source of food. We're asking that all persons attending the market to follow the CIG and HAS recommended actions regarding COVID protocol. Finally, the Water Authority. We have closed its office to the public effective today to protect for the health and safety of our customers and our staff. Penalties will be waived for the month of March. The authority has developed a COVID-19 payment deferral policy for customers facing financial hardship due to coronavirus pandemic. Customers can contact the authority via email info@waterauthority.ky. That's info@waterauthority.ky. Our phone 949-2337, 949-2837, to discuss a customer service representative in a payment plan if deemed necessary. In the interest of public health, the authority has postponed all disconnections until further notice. Customers that were previously disconnected due to past non-payment are asked to contact the authority via email so that proper and adequate arrangements can be made to reconnect to your service. The authority is providing essential services only. These are services that will ensure that customers have water supply and wastewater services. There are a variety of ways for customers to make payments. Payments can now be made online by visiting the authority's website, www.waterauthority.ky, or through our local banks. Customers can pay with a check via the authority's office drop box. Cash payments can be made via local bank counters or at our post offices. The water staff will continue to work on rotation or remotely where possible. That is my update for today. And let me just say that although I will be returning to my constituency this afternoon, we have been operating via Zoom, and we're in contact with my team. I have a very capable team, and if at any time questions need to be asked, Ms. Satonia, my chief officer, is ready, as well as Ms. Monty, who's here today, Wilbur, and Ms. Tammy. Julia is just a phone call away, and my team has been doing a tremendous job, and I want through Honorable Premier and through Your Excellency to thank them for their work that they have been carrying out assiduously and for their dedication for love of this country.
Thank you, Honorable Juliana. Honorable Minister for Health, Dwayne Seymour.
Good evening to the people of the Cayman Islands, including Cayman Brac and Little Cayman. Because it's been 9 days since we have now historically had a press conference in the Cayman Islands, some people are saying it's like the old days of waiting for Dallas and Falcon Crest at 2 p.m. every day. That's a light moment. Once again, I want to thank all those persons who have adhered to the measures the government has put in place for the whole country's safety. These are times to show leadership, and I can say I am proud of the civil service, the cabinet, the HSA, all the medical providers in the Cayman Islands for responding with such speed and calm. They, at times, are working nonstop. We thank you all for the compliments you send us, as this helps us reaffirm we are taking some of the right steps. We are at the start of this, and we want you to brace yourselves as this elevates, and it will. But if you do what we have suggested with your social spacing and isolating yourself and not leaving your homes unless it is necessary, we will respond quickly to this and coming out on the other end may be quicker than some may think, but we have to do and follow the measures that are put in place. Maybe there will be more closings, more restrictions. We have tried to move as necessary, knowing full well that our people are not used to these measures for so long, especially. And I hear some of the parents, as mentioned earlier, who are having some challenges with their online learning with some of their children and so forth. I say to you, I know it's consuming right now. I can only say as a comfort, it will not last forever. And the more we do to restrict our movements in the public, the faster we are going to come back to some normalcy. The 1-800-534-6463 is the mental health hotline. That's 1-800-534-6463. That is the promise number that I said I would get for you. The mental health hotline. Also, there's a prescription hotline or WhatsApp line, and I want to take the time to say that it's 925-6534. It's a prescription WhatsApp line. So step one, you take a photo of your prescription label. Step two, you send the photo to 925-6534. Via WhatsApp. And step three, you pick up the prescription the next day at the Cayman Islands Hospital Pharmacy. Please, please, let's love the process, not just the end game. God bless.
Thank you, Minister. I will now open the floor up to the media.
Thank you, Donna. Good afternoon. Reshma Raghunath, Cayman Compass. I'll start with you first, Dr. Lee, and your announcement today. Can you tell us first, are all the tests completed now for the COVID-19?
Tests are accruing every day, so no, they're not complete. It's anticipated that we will continue to run the tests as regularly as required in order to run the samples. At my last count, there were around 12 outstanding, but that number's probably gone up a bit since I was given that figure.
Okay, so for all intents and purposes, the initial 60 cases have all been completed?
Yeah, sorry. The 60 were the ones that have been done locally. There were the five previously that were sent off to CAFA. So it was 65 up until yesterday. And then there's another 23 from today.
Okay.
In order to try and help this particular issue, because I know people really want to know these figures, I think it's operative, or it will be today or tomorrow. We'll have a dashboard on gov.ky/coronavirus so you can track the figures yourself.
Okay, thank you. That would be helpful. You made a statement saying you now require all returning residents to isolate themselves. So it's now mandatory isolation as opposed to voluntary isolation. Am I correct?
That's correct. That if you do not comply with that, that there you are guilty of an offence.
So can you tell us what the penalty for this offence will be?
My understanding, and this is something that's just come up and I need to clarify, but my understanding it would be the same penalty as to be in breach of the regulations that were previously announced about, and that would be 6 months imprisonment or a fine.
Okay. So can
up
you
to 6 months imprisonment or a fine.
Yeah, sorry. $1,000 fine, right? Can you tell us why you decided or why this decision was taken to implement mandatory self-isolation or mandatory isolation?
There appear to have been a lot of concerns and reports that people may not be complying. I don't have fine granularity around that issue, but because it's of such utmost importance in order to protect the health of the people of Cayman, we felt it was necessary to compel people to stay put.
In terms of the arriving or returning students, we know that they had the option to go to the hotels for isolation. Now, will returning residents also be sent to that isolation hotel?
They can still isolate in their own homes. Nothing has changed really about how we would like them to isolate, but we're just now requiring it rather than just requesting it.
But is that option available to returning residents? I don't know if you may be able to, or
I do not. I have to admit, I don't have the latest update on that myself. I'm not sure if Honourable Premier has.
I believe it was for students and essential staff.
Premier, maybe you can shed some light. Is that an option available to returning residents as well?
If there is the demand for it, absolutely, we'll put it in place, because we can simply get another one of the hotels if we have issues around rooms. But most people will want to self-isolate at home or somewhere else rather than be put up. That's certainly the experience we've had so far.
Dr. Lee has something else to say before we move on.
I just have a few points I hope I might like to raise. The first is just to reiterate that the fact that the restrictions you're hearing, the words that you're hearing from the people on this panel and right across the community from all the doctors are really, the intent is for you not to mix with people. So please, will you comply with the intent of what we're trying to do? Don't gather together in groups, whether it be a sports group or any sort of community group. Don't use your strata pool. Please do not gather at any place where you might mix and share with other people, even if temporarily there might be a little bit of a gap. The only thing we really think that you ought to do is to go on a walk or a run on your own or in your family group, your household. That's what we think, because that you'll be doing essentially in an isolated group. That's the intent of what we're trying to achieve. So please, everybody in Cayman, try not to mix with other people and keep your distance. I had a few other things to say. Secondly, it's a point that's been raised, so I just want to bring it out that if COVID becomes more widespread, then rather than people coming to Georgetown, yes, we will be having access to flu clinics in the districts. That will certainly happen. As far as the dogs are concerned, you'll see that our sheet has changed now to update our advice to be in line with what other countries have also changed their advice, is that there's no evidence that pets can be infectious, and we've lowered the level of what we're saying. And lastly, I know a lot of people have been texting me today and yesterday about the issue of hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine, as there's been shown some advantage in initial drug trials as far as these drugs are concerned. I suspect there may be some truth to that. More studies are running now. So for the professionals that are in Cayman, whether they be pharmacists or doctors, please continue to act responsibly with regards to prescriptions for hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine, because we may need to preserve those stocks for use for people who are seriously unwell. So please act responsibly.
Thank you, Dr. Lee. Kevin?
Good afternoon, Kevin Morales, Cayman Compass. Dr. Lee, can you talk a little bit about the tests that the governor has spoke about when we opened the press conference? We talked on our chat earlier today that before anything like that would be, I guess, used or implemented, they would have to be approved by the CDC in the United States and other organizations. How long does that process usually take?
It usually takes quite a while, Kevin. But I have heard wind that there are some tests that are getting through that process. I know everybody's running an accelerated process, and basically you just have to run hundreds of these kits versus the thing that you trust and see what the results are. So if you put enough people to the task, just as, you know, when you're in a war state, you throw enough people and supplies into the job that the results should pop out quicker. So I hope it'll be soon, and I'm really hopeful that PHE may be able to get some supplies to us. It'll probably change how we approach this disease, and it may allow us, and I'm blue sky thinking here, if we have enough of the test kits so that we can test it whenever we want to, just at the drop of a hat, it may allow us to consider some of the restrictions or relaxing some of the restrictions. But we'll have to work out very carefully how that's done and how we use the test in order to achieve that.
And speaking of that, any update on the reagents since yesterday?
No.
Okay. And I know that...
I know they were sent, but I don't know if they've arrived yet.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I know we had talked earlier in the week about, for the local testing kits, we have to continue to send them off to CARPA until, and correct me if I'm wrong, until we've got enough correct results locally that we can trust that the local tests are correct. And my second follow-up question is, so far, have we been at 100%?
As far as the
local tests?
We have not received any results back yet from CARPA.
From CARPA, okay.
And I will tell you when we have those. They were sent, they hadn't arrived as of first thing this morning. I haven't had an update since.
Okay. All right. Thank you. My next question is for the Premier, Mr. McLaughlin. It's interesting to hear you guys talk about enforcing this law with the returning students to make sure that they're acting responsibly. My question is, how do we enforce that? How would the police even know who a returning student is? Or are you relying on people to make reports, et cetera?
All of the above. In the case of the students, we know who they are, or the system does. Once we get reports that people are wandering around that just came in, you know, someone's going to come and look for them. It's very difficult to enforce. I mean, I've said that all along, because we're talking about, even now, still quite a few hundred people. We've got two more flights, one tomorrow and one on Sunday, from the UK. But we've had many, many flights and many thousands of people coming back home over the course of the last 2 weeks. All of those should be in self-isolation too. Wow.
Thank you.
Kevin, can I just add to that?
Oh, sure.
Please can I just advise, it's exceedingly dangerous for a young person to be have any amount of activity that has been sanctioned by the legal system on their record. It can really jeopardize their future, and the young people should think exceedingly careful about crossing that line, because visas, job applications, everything may be prejudiced for quite some time.
That leads me to a question for the Honorable Minister of Education that relates to returning students. If a student who's on a government scholarship is found to have broken this mandatory isolation request, can their scholarship be withdrawn? Is that something that would be considered?
I think it would depend on the circumstances. Obviously, it would be a criminal breach, and we would certainly support that, but we'd have to see what the circumstances are. I think that for now we ought to just concentrate to send a message out that this is not a joke. The entire government supports them not breaching it, and that there will be consequential issues after that. I don't think it could be scholarship, but it could also involve more, so I would not like to isolate it to just the scholarships. But certainly, as Minister of Education, I want to support everything that has been said here. We put a lot of money, millions of dollars. I have a budget of about $12 million a year that we put into scholarships. This is the future and the cream of the Cayman Islands. So we expect that that level of responsibility is taken very seriously, and that they stay put either at home in self-isolation or in the provided accommodation, because prevention is everyone's business.
Okay. A question from Wendy at Cayman News Service for Dr. Lee. She's asking if you could clarify your comments made yesterday that people who may have COVID-19 but who are asymptomatic cannot spread the virus. She said that this is disputed by many medical professionals.
Yeah. It's come up countless times. This applies to adults, the advice, and essentially it is the advice that you'll find on, for example, Centers for Disease Control of the United States, that people, if you're not symptomatic, you're unlikely to be a significant cause of transmission, essentially because you're not coughing and sneezing. So even though your viremic load may be very high in the 24 hours before you actually develop symptoms. That advice may change with time, but it is currently the advice that's widely given by all the international large agencies of public health, which is why you're hearing it from me as well. I think the restrictions that we've put in place around trying to reduce people's movements will have a far-reaching effect, and will hopefully mean that even that advice is aided by the restrictions that we've put in. The situation for children is different. It's highly likely that children can go through a carrier process, whether they're actually having the problem or not, with COVID and not have any symptoms at all. So I was referring to the adults, yeah.
Okay. Another question from Wendy at CNS. Premier McLaughlin, I believe this one is for you. Given the low interest rates, Will the Cayman Islands government consider expanding what is now relatively low debt and doing some significant borrowing as a safety net and a way to fund expansion of public sector to keep people in jobs and the economy going? Maybe for a finance person? I don't know.
Those are all things that we are going to discuss intently over the course of the next little while. What we cannot allow to happen is for government to become cash-strapped, as I said earlier, so that we can't pay our outgoings and we can't support our people in this time of need. We will do everything we have to do and call on the UK to assist us in that regard. I don't mean necessarily for them to give us money, but I mean to relax ratios and so forth around public finances so that we are able to do what we need to do to get through this time.
And let me just add, I know already the UK is looking very carefully at all that and will of course be very sympathetic of the situations that all the overseas territories face. So, I don't envisage that being a problem.
A question as it relates to private schools. Some people are asking if any type of relief is going to be offered either to parents for fees. For private schools, apparently they still have to pay the fees, but the kids are not in school. Minister of Education.
What I would suggest, I mean, obviously government each year gives $1 million to our private schools, and they have a formula that they use for distribution of the same. That was scheduled to come to a close to the 30th of June, and we were implementing a new system where they could apply to Education Council for special projects. Also, that was pre-coronavirus, and because this government, which I'm honored to be a part of, led ably by the Honorable Premier, takes education as one of our major priorities. Mm-hmm. If they would contact, I would say in the first instance, DES, Department of Educational Services, put their proposal forward so that we can get a grip of it and have a considered position. I would not want to go out on a limb and say yes, no, maybe so, because we are fiscally responsible government, and we want to ensure that it is a considered decision.
Okay. Someone was asking about British Airways, the flight crews, who normally would go and stay or whatever. Will they be disembarking the British Airways flights from now till Sunday?
They will, and that's because normally they would go via Bahamas, and sort of that's how this is normally dealt with. But full precautions have been taken to sort of isolate the BA crews that will be here. So that has all been fully considered and fully taken care of. But yes, we obviously want these flights to come in, and we need to help people get backwards and forwards. So we had no alternative, but we have managed the risk fully.
Okay. There's a question from a group of folks who are from Suriname and Guyana, who said that their employees that are now without jobs, but their borders have been closed since the 14th and the 17th of March. And obviously they're panicking because they can't afford to stay here, yet they can't go home to their home countries.
Right. So this is a question I've addressed at a previous. So we won't let people who are here be without a roof over their head, without food to eat, and without the means to live, regardless of where they come from, regardless of what their circumstances are. We recognize fully that this is a worldwide crisis. The borders of many, many countries have been shut. And what I would urge the individuals to do is to call the NAU. The number in Grand Cayman, I presume they're in Grand Cayman, is 946-0024. Or send in an email and explain the circumstances so that we can take the necessary action to ensure that they're looked after for as long as they absolutely have to be here. But I would hope, they obviously had employers, that their employers would step up to the mark and at a minimum help them through this process, if not actually help them financially.
I mean, I just want to add that I fully support what the Premier has just said. And I think once we get past this weekend, we are going to find there are probably quite a lot of people who are in a situation which is difficult, whether it's not having income or funds or a job, but also there may be travel needs. And as we've closed all scheduled services, which is why I mentioned as well this new emergency travel hotline which will be set up, because I think we need to assess what the issues are and then see what we can do to address some of those, because we have closed our airports and we as a government have an obligation to people who are here as well. And we want to see what we can do. There may be a role also for the UK in this, because it will be an international sort of travel aspect.
Premier McLaughlin, I heard what you just said about employers, but over the last few days, there have been lots of complaints, particularly as it relates to employers of small businesses, who too will be struggling and are struggling thus far during this time, that can't help folks like we just talked about. And the big companies that are able to do it have already stepped up to the plate to do it. So I think there are going to be a lot of people that are going to be saying, well, I can't get the help because they can't help. They need the help themselves. The number for NAU, again, is 946-0024. For anyone who needs assistance, you can call them. And, of course, if they meet the criteria, they will get the assistance that's needed. Any more questions from the floor? Ralph?
My first question is for Dr. Lee. Ralph Lewis from Caymanian Times. Can you please provide an update on Health City's progress in coming back online with your services?
They're doing a good job, as we knew they would. I previously mentioned that Public Health England came and worked through the processes and some workflows for them to manage the people who had been affected, and also for the remainder of the hospital, which was large parts of it were not affected. I can't speak for them. You'd have to contact them directly about how they're going to stage their reopening. But I'm fairly reliably told that many of the staff came out of quarantine yesterday. I think they're going to take about a week to get up to full running.
All right.
I can say, Dr. Lee, I've been speaking to them about that, and pretty much what you're saying is right on point. Within the next week or so, what they are gauging also, if I may say, is they won't move forward until CARFA has clarified our results here.
Okay. The second question is in topic of one of my favorite topics, personal finance. In the next couple of weeks and months to come, everyone's going to be worrying about their money, even the wealthy as well. Will the government consider foregoing some of its revenues in the form of reducing taxes in order to impact things such as fuel prices? And because that sort of affects everybody overall. So that, in a sense, trickles down to electricity costs. Is the government considering in the future plans to maybe forego some taxes in order to assist with the shortage in cash?
The duty on fuel imported for the purpose of generating electricity is only 25 cents a gallon. It's not going to make very much difference for government to remove that. Yes, government is going to look at whatever it can do. We are operating on the basis that this is temporary, albeit how long temporary means is not within our grasp. The knowledge of that is not within our grasp at this point. But I've gone through some of the measures that utilities and banks are taking to reduce the outgoings of businesses and individuals. Those, I think, will go a long, long way. If you don't have to pay your water bill or your CUC bill or your mortgage for 3 months, that is money, significant money. As long as you're still earning something, that's a significant savings. The problem is that for many people, they're just not going to have jobs. So they're not going to have any income. So as many businesses as we can keep going, so that they can hire people, including government itself. We're going to do whatever we can to ensure that that happens.
And my final question is to do with public transportation. Have taxi drivers and bus drivers been advised on what steps they should take to protect their passengers, to wearing a mask and cleaning the bus properly?
Well, we have not advised people that they should wear masks. Dr. Lee will explain to you that unless you are symptomatic, that actually is not terribly effective and may actually create a false sense of security about how safe you actually are. I've indicated some what I call common sense things that people should be doing, distancing themselves as far as possible and not overloading the vehicles. I can say that Cabinet will shortly make regulations that actually govern the density of people allowed on public transport, preventing people from or not allowing people to stand, and various other measures. We have somebody looking at that. Now, the issue was raised, I think, yesterday at the press briefing, and we've taken it away as a concern. And we'll make the appropriate regulations.
Felicia Rankin-Solins, Radio Cayman. There are older people who are on their own and suffer from chronic illnesses but are advised not to go out. So how do they get assistance? Because we've heard some people have also checked NAU's website, but they haven't found relevant information to tell them what to do.
Well, they'll have to find, obviously, someone to help them. I had a situation last night with an older lady who needed some. She wanted to go out and get groceries herself, so I had to try to arrange somebody to go and help her with those things. So this is a community effort. There is no way that the government system is going to be able to provide each and every little service that every person needs. So we're going to have to do what Cayman has always, and you notice I said Cayman and not just Caymanians, Cayman has always done in times of crisis, help to look after each other.
Minister of Education, this is for you. Do you have any advice for those who compete in individual sports like track and field or swimming and who may have been in the middle of prepping for bigger events and games like the Olympic sports later on in the future with things up in the air. What advice should be given for them in this period since things are put on pause?
I would strongly advocate that they do individual training. A lot of them have participated before, as we've pretty much canceled all of our local sporting events that we have control over. Certainly we've pulled the team for a Crifter. We're watching what's going to happen with Olympics in July in Tokyo. They haven't yet decided as far as where until yesterday. I would hope that they used all of the information that they have and cancel based on information that we have. But if not, I would be strongly recommending that our team does not participate unless there's an act as Noah's intervenes to show that there's a complete clearance because of the travel route. And with the genesis of coronavirus there, I think it's going to be extremely high risk. But their World Games are the games that will be coming up. I would ask them to do individual training. In the age of technology, that can be done with their coaches through phones and through guidance. But to refrain from that communal participation as much as possible.
If I could ask a quick question. The directive for school closures, does this also apply to private healthcare businesses that deal with special needs children and adults as well?
When we sent the directive out, it was for all educational institutions, and we expect that wherever learning is going on, whether it's for SEN, special education needs, or otherwise, that they should now be closed.
Premier McLaughlin, some civil servants would like to know. Some civil servants would like to know if they will get paid early in April as well. They got paid early in March. So.
They give me far too much credit. Those things don't get asked of me. Ask His Excellency.
Yeah, we will take that away.
Okay. Do you have another question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, go
thank
ahead.
Thank you, Donna. This one is for Dr. Lee. Now, you mentioned patients who are using hydroxychloroquine. Some of whom are severely ill and need these medications for survival. Are you recommending then for those patients to get their prescriptions filled at this point to ensure that they have this medication should the need arise or there be a global shortage with the demand for this drug?
I mean, obviously, those are a critical, absolutely critical bunch, and they must have access to their regular supplies. What we don't want to see is for prescriptions popping up for people who don't currently have a need for it, that we really don't want to see. But anybody who's currently on that medication, and it's often for quite complex reasons that they're on some sort of immunosuppression, they should remain on it.
So is there any way to ensure that pharmacists don't, say, fall victim to people who pass under-the-counter cash so that they could get prescriptions this particular drug?
I haven't been able to update myself with everything that's happened so far today. I have seen something, but I don't know where it's gone, from the Health Practice Commission to a group suggesting that they act responsibly, but haven't got the details of it. I just glanced at it very quickly. I can certainly say that as far as the Health Services Authority is concerned, any new prescriptions for the drugs in question will need to go through the chief pharmacist, so they have put a stop to any and they'll have the biggest supply on the island to put a stop to any new prescriptions that look like they may not be warranted at the moment.
Okay. I can say Reshma that I've spoken. I saw the reports and I saw President of the USA endorsing this product, and I know that there would be a rush, and I spoke to the CEO of the HSA, and yes, we do have the drug on hand. We have a considerable enough amount, and more is on the way also. More has been ordered because of what we've seen, so we're on it.
Okay, thank you very much. That's critical. Premier, this is a question for you. Yesterday we talked about the NAU situation, and you promised to undertake into an inquiry into what's happening with calls and applications and the problems. Can you brief us on that?
Yes, thank you. I did. The reason why people couldn't get through is it hadn't yet been set up, but I don't know whether it was the questions here or what, but it's up and running now. And as I said before, the number is 946-0024 for Grand Cayman, 948-8758 for Cayman Brac. 948-8758 for Cayman Brac.
Okay.
So, as I said, we've they've sent home. That sounds terrible. They're allowing a number of people to work from home, and they're setting the system up so that they can answer these calls, do the applications over the phone, the interview and so forth, so they're able to assess whether or not people qualify for the assistance. And the email is NAU, capitals, INFO, at gov.ky. NAU info at gov.ky.
Thank you for that. Now, you also announced some good news when it comes to the banks and the concessions that they're giving to their customers. Are those, or is there anything that you can say to landlords or people who are renting from individuals who may benefit from these tax break, these payment breaks? Because we've gotten concerns about that from members of the public, that the owners of the properties are benefiting from this. Is there any way, I know we have no rent control, but is there any way or any plea that you may make for these individuals to pass on the same savings that they are benefiting from onto their tenants?
Well, of course, I would encourage everyone to act in as charitable a manner as possible can in these grave circumstances. But that probably isn't worth a whole lot. But this I know is this thing called market forces. Right? So in very short order, we are going to know what the impact of thousands of people leaving here really means and the absence of visitors. There is going to be a plentitude of apartments to choose from, and that is going to drive rents way down. Now, that is obviously bad news for landlords, but those who are paying mortgages will themselves have a break in terms of servicing those mortgages for 3 months, at least in the first instance, until everybody has a chance to see how this epidemic plays out. So I've heard a lot of anxiety. People call me, people write me, people see me and ask me. And that's what I've said to them. Just hang tight for a week or two, and you'll be able to bargain with your landlord.
Okay. One final, and I'll thank you. Now, yesterday the police commissioner was here, and he talked about projecting an increase in domestic violence reports with people being in confined spaces and situations like that. Has government contemplated providing any sort of provisions for the safety of victims who may find themselves in these abusive situations so that they can, one, protect themselves from the violence, but also keep safe from the pandemic that is currently happening?
Oh, you really pick the easy questions, don't you?
Well, I mean, there is the Cayman Arts Crisis Center.
I was going to say,
we've
got a range of agencies and hotlines that are available. If we see that, you know, they're being overwhelmed, then obviously we'll deploy additional resources there so that people are able to be dealt with. As I've said before, there is the upside. Well, that's probably even wrong to say upside, but the thing is that with so many people gone and with no tourist industry anymore, facilities to put people who are in trouble for one reason or another are generally available, and the private sector has been magnanimous, quite frankly, in offering these facilities. So I'm confident that if that should become an issue, we'd be able to find a way to work through it.
Premier McLaughlin, someone is noting, if it hasn't been thought of yet, that we should ensure that fishermen feed the stingrays at Stingray City. If not, one of our main attractions will be gone. Because there are no tourists going out there every day. There are no, you know.
So the Premier goes out in his boat to feed them. He's got enough to do at the moment.
Premier is a farmer, not a fisherman.
They're worried about one of our main attractions. You know, if they're not fed, they'll migrate somewhere else.
Yeah.
It's, you know, yeah.
No, it's a fair. It's a fair.
Yeah. So we've got to make sure the fishermen feed them.
I think they've heard.
Yes. All right, Kevin.
Mr. McLaughlin, and obviously you're going to need fuel to fill up your boat. You had mentioned a little bit earlier in the press conference about Rubis. I believe it was slashing its cost by 30 cents per gallon.
40
cents per gallon. Thank you.
Per imperial gallon.
Per imperial gallon. Thank you. Other than, I guess, making the recommendation here, is there anything that you can do or the government can do to ensure that the retailers follow suit? And the reason I'm curious about it is I was actually looking this morning. Over the last month in the U.S., the national average has dropped by something like 30 cents, where in Cayman, I believe it was 5. So what can we do to make sure that the retailers here are step in step with the fuel prices, I guess, abroad and what they're being offered by someone like Rubis?
Well, the comparisons aren't right across the board, which is the mistake many people make, is that you're talking about U.S. gallons as opposed to imperial gallons. So imperial gallon is quite a bit more than a U.S. gallon. So they're not direct comparisons. And then there are travel, transport costs, and all of those other things that have to get added on. But I don't think that we're going to really have an issue with this time, because this is an edict that is coming from Rubis themselves. So... and they control most of the stations themselves. So I'd be surprised if this proves to be a problem.
Okay, thank you. My next question is for the education minister. Would you mind running down again the cancellation of the tests and what can be done for families and students in terms of rescheduling or et cetera?
Mm-hmm. Well, rescheduling.
Well, the test... our overseas tests, mm-hmm. So we are reliant on those examination bodies. Some of them, all of them actually, we're still in dialogue with them, in particular the CXC. We don't have any determinant as to what they're going to do. Fortunate for Cayman, it is affecting all of the regions, so it will be a level platform. You know, what is done for Trinidad will be done for Cayman as well. As far as the UK is concerned, our information... that I've been provided was that the UK cancelled it. Now, since that, there have been some question as to whether it's been cancelled just for the UK or whether it's been cancelled for the international centres as well. And we'll seek to elucidate on that, and we'll provide Honourable Premier with an answer at the next press briefing if we're in receipt of that information from the UK.
Okay, thank you. You'd also talked about e-learning. We've had a couple people reach out to us and say, you know, hey, listen, what if we don't have internet access in our home? What can families in that situation do? And has government considered at all providing Wi-Fi to families in that situation?
Well, the good thing is, as a government, without knowing what was going to happen now, we allocated laptops to every single teacher in the public system before. So that, in effect, makes it easier for the dissemination of the information to those who may have internet. Because we're also aware, and in addition, we've done this survey, which I indicated we had 1,600 responses and hope to get more at the close of the date today, so that we can better do a forensic audit to see what obtains with who has access to internet and who doesn't. Because we are sending out the actual packages, but of course you'll always find somebody falling through the social stratification and for whatever reason not coming in. I've said to the team from last week, to look and see what the cost is for providing iPads or laptops to the relevant student level, whether ski stage 1 through 4. I think discussions need to occur as well as we talk with Flo about them taking the social responsibility, digital and other ICT, to provide more hotspots into the territory. I saw in watching World News that that had been done, for example, in Florida. They ensured that it was, you know, free access. So Perhaps with the kind permission of the Honourable Premier, if I could use this medium to ask the ICTA to take that social responsibility. Cayman has been good for them, and I can say that. I worked as an accountant for Flo many years ago. If they would take that responsibility to ensure that those who had limited packaging for data, at the minimum, if they could increase that and to look actively to providing all of our students. And perhaps if I would be permitted with indulgence, Mandela said that if you think that education is expensive, try ignorance. We are a nation-growing community, and everyone needs to come on board because there is absolutely no way that government can be expected to be expended all these funds, which we, through the ABLE leadership career, we have been doing, but also be asked to decrease the inflow, because if you have an output and no inputs, we know where we're going to end up. And we have proven to be a fiscal responsible government, luckily with a very healthy reserve, but it's going to take true partnership. Cayman, I reemphasize, has been good to many, many here. Let's come on board and ensure we weather this storm.
Thank you.
Okay, with that, we're going to end the press briefing this afternoon. We know that our leaders have important decisions to go away and make. Hopefully things will stay stable over the weekend. So on Monday, we'll be back here again with you here on CIG TV. We'd like to also thank our sign language interpreter, Ms. Carolyn Powell, for joining us here. We wish everyone a safe weekend.
Good to talk, everybody.